Desautels, and I'm a part of the Student Labor Action Committee as part of the Free the Falls Coalition. I'm going to be your MC for this afternoon's session. So I want to thank you so much for seeing such a full room in here. My partner asked me this morning, she said, so how many folks do you think you're going to be speaking to this afternoon? And I said, 10. Because I knew we were in competition with some great performances that are happening outside this room. So by me telling you how grateful I am that you're here means that you can't get up and leave until we're finished. So I want to get things started in a good way with a good friend and a wonderful human being, Barbara Hill Dumont, who's going to open us and welcome you to the
Quick way. Hello, good morning. I hope you're all living your life in a good way. Anishinaabe, Quay, Barbara Dumont-Hill, Nijinja Kazo, Ikanakti Dodum, Tikan Zibi, Nijinjabai. I am a proud Anishinaabe woman. My name is Barbara Dumont-Hill. I am Turtle Clan from Tikan Zibi. Today I welcome you all on our beautiful unceded Algonquin territory. The song I'm going to open with is a welcome song, welcoming in our ancestors, the grandfathers, the grandmothers, all our relations to be here with us, to help us today, for all the things that are in our hearts, for all the things that we know are important, that are sacred. I was saying someone this week about how those Chaudière Falls, how sacred they are. And I had someone say to me, well, all the land is sacred. You're right, all the land is sacred. But those islands, those falls, there's those water spirits, our ancestors are there. Ceremonies that took place. Want people to come back and do ceremonies there. And we are all responsible to be there to pray. And so when I'm calling for ancestors to be here, it's all your ancestors, no matter who you are. I want them all here with us.
Away, 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 away
everyone.
Barbara was joined there by Gabrielle, Fayant, who will be recording for us later here as well, too. I now want, so I should tell you that I work for the Public Service Alliance of Canada as the Indigenous Rights Officer. And we have a national Aboriginal people's circle that comes from people that come from across the country to Ottawa a couple times a year to plan campaigns and strategies on the rights of Indigenous peoples. And ever since the formation of this national circle, we've been fortunate to have as our spiritual advisor and friend, Albert Dumont from Kittigan, Zibi.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Barbara, for the great song. I want to speak to you about my right, a God-given right that I have, to have a place of prayer and ceremony, a healing place. It's not a human right, it's a God-given right. Whenever I look around the community and the way the world is going, technology, and the power of money, what it's doing to our minds, what it's doing to our descendants, I know that we have to access these healing places to be able to understand more clearly that we're not machines that are expected to go to a job site and follow orders and work 9 to 5. That's not the purpose of life of anybody. Our purpose of life is to heap praise on all the things Creator has placed in our territories that help us, the human beings, to live well. Chaudière Falls is such a place. It's a powerful place where water flows, where a person could go and to feel like a human being, to understand something about the heart that's beating in their chest, to be able to understand something about commitment and duty to our families, to our community, to this country, to the trees and the birds, the animals and the fish. We've got a duty to them. They are stronger than we are. They understand purpose, and we don't. It's something that has been kicked to the curb, as my granddaughter would say. That purpose of life, why we should keep all things healthy, the difference it makes when a person begins their day with a prayer of thanksgiving, because there's always something to be thankful for. There's never a time when there's nothing to be thankful for. If your health is poor, well, someone you love has good health, and we're thankful for that. We have to understand about the fact that we'll all be ancestors someday. And 300 or 400 years from now, when we're all dead and gone, the ones in this room, what will we have left? What will they be able to say, our descendants, about this time in history, this moment, about the falls, and what we did and what we didn't do? We have to take it seriously to protect a sacred site. You know, it means everything. It's not fun and games. It's a serious thing, spirituality. And if there's anybody in this room that doesn't believe that they have a soul or something will continue to live, I feel sorry for that person. Because I know that I'm going to live again. I know that I'm going to hear an honor song sung for me when my heart stops beating. And it's going to be because of the love, respect, and honor that I have for sacred places like the Chaudière Falls. A small falls on on an obscure river can do great things for a human being. But those falls are unique on the Ottawa River, the Grand River of the Algonquins. We need to understand what it means. We're just weak human beings. We need to understand, and we really do need to understand about a soul and a heart and the future. Ancestors and descendants. The love we have for our grandchildren and our grandchildren's grandchildren, yours and mine, to be fair and just and to be able to go to a place and appreciate it, to let the place talk to you, that sacred place. So we're going to have a good day today, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Elder. Everybody who's engaged in this kind of work that all of us are brings a unique talent to the table. And our next presenter brings several. So not only being a committed social activist, Tito Medina has served the labor movement and the broader social justice movement in helping in almost every event I've ever been at to set up the sound and set up the lights so that we all have an enjoyable experience. So I want to thank and welcome Tito Medina.
Oh yeah! Proclamation of freedom and strength. People of all nations, people of all trends, enjoy this celebration of freedom and strength. Idle no more, idle no one fountain of life. In the spirit world, the forest is the one who cares for our waters. Sometimes we just destroy our water sources. We don't care for it. We prefer to see it captured, prisoner inside a plastic bottle. Agua vida. Manantial de la esperanza mía, agua en sueño, el bosque es tu nahual, tu dueño, agua, cerro, lluvia, cantera, que corres arriba o abajo de la tierra. Agua, he eres toda mi verdad, mi vida entera. Querida, te destruyo, te derrocho y contamino. Agua mía, y ahora vienes a mi casa y me halagas con tu dulce compañía. Agua vida, manantial de la esperanza mía, agua mía, manantial de la esperanza mía. Driving from Ontario to Quebec, remember that the Ottawa River is there to be free. Thank you.
Thank you, Tito, for reminding us just how critically important art is to the work that we do, and how lucky we are to have such talent in our midst. While I'm on thanking people, I want to thank Greg McDougall, who's sitting there filming as we speak, who's done most of the legwork in bringing all of these speakers together, contacting them and setting them up, and making sure that we were all on track. So thanks to Greg. EquitableEducation.ca. So our next presenter, of course, needs no introduction. But again, I want to thank him for the tireless work of his time and of his resources that he's committed to the preservation of Chaudière Falls, and what a great, great spokesperson he's been for this movement. And we are so lucky to have him on our side. Douglas Cardinal.
I just want to remember the sacrifices that my elders made in leaving their communities and being in the mountains in Alberta and living under very harsh conditions because they couldn't practice their culture. It was forbidden in the reserves and the communities. Couldn't practice any of the ceremonies. So they moved up to the mountains where it was very hard. We had to ford rivers and everything together. And they dedicated their lives to preserve our beautiful culture so that they could pass it on to us. I was fortunate to be one of the people that was trained by these elders. And I was so fortunate to be able to participate in all the ceremonies and the beautiful traditions of our people when most people were denied that. So that is a beautiful gift that the elders have given me. And in that gift, I learned how absolutely beautiful our Anishinaabe culture is. How it comes from the heart, loving and caring. How it connects us with all living beings. How it connects us with our Mother, the Earth, how it connects us with everyone. And so I saw that it is the way to live one's life. And I've had the gift of being an architect and to bring people's visions into reality, and that has been my job, that is the gift that they gave me. I was asked by these elders to serve our people in a good way. And I was also asked to take on Trudeau and the white paper policy and with our 52 chiefs of Alberta and get Indigenous rights in our constitution and to get Indian control of our education, which we did. And however, I was also asked by the elders. They said, we have a vision for you, and you're going to come to Ottawa and build a strong monument in front of our nation's capital. Because we want them to realize that we and our culture are not going to go away. And when they look outside the windows, they'll see a very strong statement of who we are, a beautiful statement of who we are. And I'm also asking you to do that in front of the Capitol in Washington as well. And that is your job. And also, when you go to Ottawa, you're to honor the Falls. Those Falls are sacred to all of our Anishinaabe people. The host nation are the Algonquins. But all of our Anishinaabe people, from our Rocky Mountain house, Rocky Mountains here, to the Atlantic, all our Anishinaabe people and the South, honor those Falls. That is our sacred site. And it is the responsibility of all Algonquins to protect that site for all Anishinaabe peoples. And so they asked me if I would work with William to make sure that happened. So I made a commitment to William, as I did to my own. So that is fundamental. To those islands are sacred to us all. Not only our Anishinaabe people, we welcome all the tribes from the south and everywhere to lay down the weapons and come and join us in peace, because we were a peaceful culture. We lived in peace. Peace and harmony, balance, that is our way. And so, the Windmill Project is a sacrilege to our culture, our people, our ceremonies, our way of being. And that has to be stopped because it shows no respect who we are. For 10,000 years or more, we've had ceremonies on those islands. They have no right to be on those islands. That's unceded Algonquin territory. What's happened? They came and pushed our people north, pushed our people away by military means. They didn't respect even the crown. They didn't respect anybody. And what is the only thing they care about is money. So it's a question that you have. $1 billion development? The government of Canada, or Indigenous rights. Choose. Yeah. Our Indigenous rights actually come from the Creator. We are one with the Creator. No man can interfere with our rights. The elders say to me, the ultimate tyrant is our Creator. He can take your life and he can take your spirit. But the petty tyrant can only take your life. And the little petty tyrant can only take your goods. We're dealing with a very little petty tyrant. As warriors, we have to stand up for tyranny. Our Creator walks with us. Don't let them disregard our rights, because we are all in this together. We're all part of creation. Those islands the Creator formed like a sacred height, that is the foundation our ceremonies. That's why the Creator did that, to honor us and honor everyone who honors those falls. So I ask you all to make sure that you stand with us, because you're also standing for yourselves when you stand with us, because we're all connected. We're all part of each other. Our next presenter, I want to let you know that William Lepchuk is going to be handing out some information about a little bit of history of the site and also ideas for action that we'll talk about a little more as we close up. I'm going to invite Gabrielle Fayant to come to the stage. She is going to start us off with some songs and then share a few words with us. Gabrielle?
Ami Bojo Tanse, Miigwech, Douglas and Albert and everybody else, Tito, Barbara, you were there, very inspiring, and we really appreciate all the things you've been doing and continue to do to lead that way for us. Mishin Dengwe Ankwa Kwe Indijnapas, Fishing Lake in Donjuba, Anishinaabe Ki in Donji, Makwado Dam. So my name is Gabrielle Fayant. I'm originally from Alberta. And I come from a Métis settlement called Fishing Lake. And I currently live here on traditional Algonquin territory in Algonquin. So that's a little bit about myself. And so we have a women's drum group called Spirit Flower. And I also have one of my co-singers with me.
Hello. My name is Amanda Fox. I come from Laquamacama, Ontario, and Ojibwe. I've been living in Ottawa all my life. Unceded Algonquin territory. I've been singing with Gabby for a few months now. I actually just started singing with the women's drum group again. I was singing with a women's drum group when I was 8 years old until I was about 12. And then I stopped and I started singing with the big drum. But yeah, it's nice to join her again, join her today. There's actually four of us, but only two of us can make it today. With you. Thanks for inviting us.
So I just wanted to share a little bit about where my family comes from and kind of my observations. I've been observing for quite a while. I'm not Algonquin, so I never say that I have any claim to this territory or have any right to really say anything. But I do have that inherent right to observe and to speak my voice. And what I see happening here is really similar to how the treaties were signed out west, how a lot of our people were starved into signing these treaties. My family, coming from that Métis background, all those buffalo, our way of being, our resource for life was massacred in front of us. So I always think about that buffalo and how they're coming back again. After so many thousands of, or hundreds of years, they're coming back again. And you know, there's that mysterious herd of buffalo just roaming around in Saskatchewan, and that makes me really happy. But with that being said, for hundreds of years, people have been hurt out west, starved into these things, and while Indigenous people honor those treaties and really had their heart and their spirit and intent in those treaties and what it meant to them, the other side wasn't at the same level. And so a lot of those treaties were never honored. So I see these corporations with that same mindset that those old governments had. You know, there's a change in our government today. However, not all Canadians are at that level either. And I see these corporations coming and taking our oppression and starving us, really, and taking advantage of those things that have happened to us and taking advantage of our pain, and we really need to heal. So the song that I was thinking would be really important for this event is called a song called Wildflower. And so the story of that song is very old. So this is a song that's been here on Turtle Island for many thousands of years probably. And it's a call and response song. So there's a woman, Barbara Hooper, and this song came to her when she was at a powwow one day. And the song came to her, this vision. And what she saw in this vision was there's the first verse. And in that vision, it's children and women. And they're doing their daily activities, like how they used to do a long time ago. So they're out, and they're probably gathering medicines and gathering berries and preparing the meals. And the second verse is about a warrior that comes, and he warns them that there's chaos that's coming. And so those women respond back. And this song is really important right now because these people are coming to you and they're warning you. They're telling you that something really bad is gonna happen if you allow it to happen. And so what I ask of you is, what's your response gonna be? Are you gonna respond in a good way, or are you gonna ignore it? Are you gonna go and tell your families what needs to happen and encourage more and more people to come out and support this cause in a good way, or are you just gonna let it slide? So that's what the song, that's the significance of this song for me. All right, so here we go. So also I have a cold, so. but I will give you my all.
Hey!
I wasn't going to be the guy that told them they were 3 minutes over their time. I'm going to take an opportunity, just before I introduce our next presenter, to interject myself into some of this discussion, which is what you get to do when you're the MC. But I just want to link some of the things that have already been said into just sort of one flowing, rambling message. And that is this: the travesty, the unthought of, unfathomable tragedy that these perpetrators are trying to inflict on Anishinaabe people in that river is compounded by two things. One is the sheer timing of it. Tito spoke or sang of the Idle No More movement. You know, a movement that's now in its third year that has sparked so much encouragement and life and pride in Indigenous people, especially Indigenous young people across this country, reconnected them to who they are and who we are as Anishinaabe people. Followed by the work that so many people did to get Canada to sign the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Mm-hmm. And then even more work to get them to embrace the spirit under which that covenant was written. The timing, after not just last week when Justice Murray Sinclair and the other two commissioners issued the final report of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission that called on Canadians, all Canadians, to do some very specific things in the spirit of reconciliation. The very next day, those, people stuck a shovel in the ground in Chaudière Falls, just as a kind of a, to people. So disrespectful, so profoundly disrespectful. And the other link I wanted to make was some of the things Gabby was saying about what happened in the West, where I come from, about how people were forced to sign treaties to live on reserve because they were starved. And that is the kind of same desperation that the developers of Windmill are doing. They go, let me give you just a gross example. We attend the Assembly of First Nations General Assemblies every year, just to, you know, meet with chiefs and talk about the work that we're doing and the like. At these assemblies, they have a trade show where resource companies come and financial companies come and try to flog their wares to chiefs and members of First Nations members that come across the country. Always, the largest display is set up by, I forget what they're called, Nuclear Energy Canada. And what they're there for is they're trying to get First Nations to take spent nuclear fuel rods into their communities. And they know that there are some communities that are so desperate, where there's so limited economic activity that they'll take it. And that's what Windmill is doing to the people, some Algonquin people. Dividing, trying to drive this cleave into Algonquin people saying, oh yeah, well, we talked to this group, they're with us, they're on side with us. But they're playing on the desperation of people who really need a leg up. But that's not the kind of leg up they need. So just the crassness in which and how and what they're doing, when they're doing it, and how they're doing it is something that we need to speak out against to all our leaders. Okay, on that cheery note, I'm really looking forward to this because I don't know Kevin Schofield, who's about to perform for us, but I'm really always looking forward to his music, so I'm happy. Kevin Schofield.
Last week, Derek Nikanak had his fast on the island with some of his contemporaries, and I was one of the fire keepers there. I have a long relationship with Victoria Island. Last week, I slept on the ground. If anybody who's been to Aboriginal experiences, there's a little fire in the center. And the fasters were in the teepees, and because there's incidences of arson on Victoria Island, I had to sleep outside on the ground. Because I couldn't sleep in a teepee because somebody might come down there all drunk and light fire to the teepee and the pastors kill them. So that's the kind of reality. And I believe so strongly in helping and protecting our people and our water that I can sleep outside in the wintertime without a blanket. Tito see me? Right, Tito? Where's Tito? Tito's not. Yeah, he was there. He came in the morning and found me sleeping. And I wasn't even shivering or nothing. You too can sleep in the snow outside. You too. And I'm lost and alone in the city. I don't have any place to go. I don't have any family. And when I go to Victoria Island, that's where I feel found. And it's the same thing for all of you. You guys all have your sacred spots. Go there, to the fire, and say it's yours. Nobody can come there. Just you and your friends and family. Drew, I don't know more. I spent time on Victoria Island with Teresa Spence and her fast. So I wrote a song about that. So this song is based on the traditional Cree song. It's called Mamet Petuswin. It's kind of a tongue twister. And it's a lullaby. It goes like this traditionally. So while the baby is sleeping, they go like that. Was some of that as a baby, and I like to think that it was a remnant of pre-contact, and it's a prayer song. Priests, they annihilated everything, every song, right? They annihilated under threat of death to make all the songs disappear. So our grandmother sang us that song, and I like to think it was a remnant, it was a trick they played on the priest. It's just a lullaby, it's just a lullaby. So we all know this song. And then years later, I heard it was a prayer song. So our ancestors kind of snuck one by the priest with this song. The path to visions burn. Many magic things. What if she never comes back again? The woman in white buckskin. Woman in white buckskin. Hey, I. something visible, something sacred, and then make it practical, secular, so you can understand it. And that's what we're going to do in Victoria Island. We're going to take magic, kind of reform it in a way that ordinary people, you can understand. And that's your place, too. And that's your great-grandchildren's place. And it's not okay. We have to do, you know, what our elders tell us. And as a helper, I always do what I'm not a chief. I don't make decisions. I just do what I'm told.
Thank you, Kevin. I'm reminded, most of you will know this quotation of Louis Riel, who said that just as they're about to murder him and hang him, he said, "My people will sleep for 100 years." But it will be the artists that awaken them. Okay, there's Romola, who will make her way to the front, who has worked very closely, as many of you know, worked very closely with my grandfather William Commanda, shared his vision, and is working very hard to keep it alive and keep it moving forward. So thank you very much for calling.
Grant, it's a great honor to be here with
lower the mic.
With this huge gang in this circle, and I'm not actually going to stand up here very long. I just wanted to thank. Our partners for the drum songs and for the prayers and for the introductory words and for the passion that people have shared. And it's not just the people who are presenters up here who have been part of developing and evolving the vision for the sacred Chaudière site. I see people from Montreal. I see people who have participated in grandfather's gatherings for over a dozen years articulate this vision. I'm going to share a PowerPoint presentation that is mainly pictures. It's our bilingual presentation, so I hope it fits in with the art criteria of this event. And then I'll fast forward through a presentation that we made to the National Capital Commission in 2008. And then I'll also assign you your homework, since this is such a dynamic presentation. I met Grandfather Commander in 1997 after many years of work in the criminal justice system, work that touched me very deeply because I myself come from South Africa and I know about the oppression of people in a very personal way. I quit working for the federal government in the criminal justice system to support Grandfather's work to create a circle of all nations, a culture of peace. And one huge project of ours was the vision for Asinabka, the sacred Chaudière site. We continue to raise awareness the best we can about this project at levels of government and community levels. And we're also challenging some thoughts about potential other work at this sacred Chaudière site through the court system and things like that. You'll find much of our information about this work at the Asinabka website, asinabka.com, but I draw your attention especially to the June 21st, 2014 report and page 21 and 22, where we talk about the legacy vision for the sacred Chaudière site, the mandate, the core vision, and what we expect would be the key results. And these results embrace all of us, so I hope you will take the time to understand this a little better. Thank you. Now, we'll carry on with our presentation.
There, it's not there, Romola. Has it disappeared?
So I will actually then tell you a little bit about the history of the project.
Ma'am, can you please use the microphone? Use the microphone.
Sorry. Okay. So a synopsis of the development of the vision for the sacred Chaudière site. In the 1970s, Douglas Cardinal and Jean Piggott with the National Capital Commission identified Victoria Island as a site for the Indigenous Center. In the 1990s, the development of ideas for the Indigenous Center at Victoria Island grew. In 1998, the presentation to the Algonquin Nation's Tribal Council by Elders William Commanda and Peter DeConte and Douglas Cardinal is supported. Between 2000 and 2002, William, Douglas, and I made road trips to all the Algonquin communities in Quebec and Ontario to develop key components of the vision. In 2000, we also made a presentation of the vision to Her Excellency, the former Governor General, Adrian Clarkson, at the Circle of All Nations Millennium Peace Gathering on Nepean Point. Nepean is an Algonquin word, and it means place where we sleep. And the Le Breton Flats area was the old Nepean. And in the language is captured the story of Indigenous peoples and their presence in this particular area over 5,000, 6,000 years at least. We say actually going back 10,000 years post the retreat of the Wisconsin glacier. And very recently, I see Roger in the room, there have been people who have been acknowledging the presence of the ancient people dating back 6,000 years, dating back 2,500 years, in historic times, evident in what was acknowledged by Champlain, by Brulé, in terms of the presence of Indigenous peoples at this particular site. And actually, just yesterday, I see there's more news about bones being uncovered in this area, which seems to confirm the presence of people here for time immemorial. Between 1998 and 2002, and actually on until 2011, the development of the vision at the annual Circle of All Nations gatherings at Bitterby Lake continued, and many of you participated in that development. And so we continue our efforts on behalf of the commitment of many people passionate about this. In 2003, Grandfather Commander hosted a gathering of Algonquin elders to present a report on the vision. In Maniwaki, it was fully supported by Algonquins from all communities on both sides of the river. In 2003, Larry McDermott undertook graduate research into governance structures for an Indigenous center in consultation with William Commander. In 2004, with support of the Ministry of Canadian Heritage and the National Capital Commission, a draft memorandum was prepared. Conceptual plans were refined by Douglas Cardinal. In 2006, the National Capital Commission endorsed the project and earmarked $35 million for the commencement of a two-phase development. But unfortunately, 2006 was also the year of the sponsorship scandal. And that is part of the larger Canadian story, and it had impacts on the development of this vision. In 2006, Elder Commander was presented with a key to the city of Ottawa. And at that formal public occasion, he presented his vision for the sacred Chaudière site. One that, oh, we're back up? Well, that's the second presentation. Maybe I'll speed up to that if you give me some time later. The Birch Park print that you might have seen earlier disturbing other people's presentations, that was the vision for the entire site that was presented publicly. But it had already been articulated in 2003 in the five circle diagram that you would find on our website. In 2006, the Circle of All Nations Waterlife Workshop drew attention to the degradation of the Ottawa River. It resulted really in the animation of Ottawa River Keepers and many other efforts to focus on the environmental prong of the vision for the Indigenous Center, respect for the water. In 2006, Elder Commander served as honorary chair to the committee to designate the Ottawa River a heritage river. In 2006 and 2007, the expansion of the hydro development at Chaudière was challenged by Circle of Four Nations and colleagues further to public discussion, not only with Aboriginal peoples, but with all peoples interested in environmental issues in November 2006. In 2007, Eric Smith, a graduate student, prepared a research report on the removal of dams and the restoration of the site. Later, he presented a master's thesis on the indigenous colonial settler relations at the Chaudière site. That might also be worth re-examining because it brings us to some of the continuing issues that impact the evolution and the advancement of our work here. In 2010, Elder Commander presented a comprehensive vision for the sacred Chaudière site and the Indigenous Center on Victoria Island. And in November 19th, 2010, the City of Ottawa endorsed the comprehensive vision for the site, and it date stamped every page of the 57-page report. And that 57-page report includes specific mention of wild space in the capital city. In 2011, William Commander presents the comprehensive vision to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth and to Governor General Mikhail Jean with respect to the honor of the crown. Now, to a certain extent, Mikhail Jean responded by creating the William Commander, Dr. William Commander Pavilion at the University of Ottawa. And in this process, we see moving from the days when Duncan Campbell Scott stifled the voice and the prayer and the song and the dance of Indigenous peoples to its re-emergence in what you've heard this morning over here. But also, William Commander, we wrote a book about him. We called it Learning from a Kindergarten Dropout. And almost immediately after that, the University of Ottawa presented him with an honorary doctorate degree. A few years later, so did the University of Quebec with Quebec. And what we see in that is the acknowledgement that it's not just old traditional knowledge that is not of great relevance to all of us that old Native people and old Native elders represent. It's actually the kind of wisdom that should transform and inform knowledge in higher level academic institutions. And so that is how we see Mikhail Jean moving towards respecting the honor of the crown. In 2013, Douglas Cardinal upgraded the conceptual designs for the sacred site. In 2013, Peace and Good Governance Citizens Group endorses the Indigenous vision and presents it to former Minister Baird, and also to the UN Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. By this, I mean to say that William Commander made overtures in the earlier stage to the Liberals who were in power. He also received considerable support from Paul Doer, and I recall the late Jack Layton attending William's birthday party, and when he heard about this vision, thought it was very inspiring, and assigned the work to Paul Doer, who then advanced it to a certain level. With the presentation of this communities group report to the former conservative leadership, we feel that we've made outreach to all levels of government and informed them all equally of the merits of this project. William Commander's colleagues from Argentina actually presented William's legacy to the United Nations Human Rights Council Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples in 2014, and in partnership also with Idle No More. And I would like to say, Idle No More has woken us up here in the capital city, but I'd also like to say, following on the footsteps of Grandfather Commander, who never idles till his dying day at the age of 98. I'd say the Circle of Four Nations, Lindsay Lambert, I'd like to acknowledge for his passion for keeping the spirit of the Chaudière Falls alive in so many hearts by his painful handwritten notes, reaching out. It's awakened the spirit of the falls in many hearts. And so we assert the key components of the vision. Four, an indigenous center on the eastern half of Victoria Island, and you may have seen Douglas Cardinal's conceptual designs. And this is a place for the First Nations, the Inuit, and the Métis to come together to recover their strength, their stories, and their histories, and reignite the passion of Indigenous on this land at the central meeting place, hosted by the people of the Ottawa River watershed, the Algonquins. And the other part of the vision is for this type of activity, for an eco-peace tank, so that people will engage in discussions about what William Commanda identified as the two critical issues of our times. The issue of respect for Mother Earth and the waters. He started to talk about this publicly in 1987 with the deconstitutional discussions on Indigenous issues. And he ignited the global prayer for Mother Earth in Paris in the pre-Rio discussions in 91. Just recently, Canada re-presented itself on the global stage in with respect to environmental issues. And we wrote to the Prime Minister and said, do not forget that you are walking in the footsteps of the Indigenous. The Indigenous were already present in this global forum to raise the profile of the urgency to address the environmental issues. A few days later, November 13th, we had the bombings in Paris, and it gave us occasion to write yet again to the Prime Minister and the federal leadership. And that was in relation to the other prong of the William Commanda work, peace building. He was born on the eve of the First World War, and the energy of global warfare very much informed his life and his thinking, and reaffirmed for him repeatedly the huge need to rebuild relationships, to look towards the spirit of Jinawidaganuk, the spirit of we're all connected. And that was then very much the passion of his prayer that he wanted to see ignited in this peace-building eco-think tank. He also felt that we needed all to reignite our relationships with Mother Earth. Most of us who are not of Indigenous roots come from someplace else where we have broken the sacred connection with Mother Earth, with our ancestral lands, with our waters. When he, like his ancestors, saw the newcomers coming in such huge numbers, he realized he needed to make them understand how they needed to connect with his Mother Earth, because he needed all of us to be part of the stewardship responsibility for his land. He knew he couldn't protect her alone, needed all of us. And he wanted Indigenous plants replanted at the Chaudière Island to reconnect all of us with the sanctuary, Central Park, New York. He also wanted to see the Chaudière Falls freed to the extent possible, despite the years of industrial devastation. And there, it's critically important to realize the symbolic message of the Chaudière Falls, where the Ottawa River flows from the west to the east, where it is joined by the Gatineau, the Tanagatin coming in from the north, and the Rideau coming in from the south, where it spins on an Indigenous natural medicine wheel and energetically contains so much of what is important to the old people. And as Kevin said, how the songs have still remained to remind us how important that is. Our PowerPoint presentation started with the spirit of the ancestors, some paintings by Bev Doolittle, and the early ancestors, like exactly Duncan Campbell Scott, being afraid of the big trees and the fearfulness of nature, and going through a whole cycle where now mental health issues are challenging us at every level, public servants, the prison systems, public schools, where little kids have to be exposed to a month of mental health education, and now our police, our responders to emergency crises are committing suicide. And we see, of course, mental health challenges reflected in the highest levels of our Canadian society today. This is the kind of deep healing that Grandfather Commander wanted to see ignited here. And it's both the responsibility and it is also the legacy gift for all of us. Be great. Thank you.
Romola, for reminding us why we all indeed are here and for giving us the incentive and the desire to keep moving forward in the footsteps of Father Commander. It just made me think, it was interesting, you know, when Romola spoke about the bones that were just recently discovered on the banks of the river, and I have to think that the ancestors took a very interesting time to reveal themselves to us. William, ever busy, is going to be passing around a sign-up sheet for anybody who's interested in receiving more information. There's going to be activities going on. There's going to be some action being taken by organizers, as we did. I don't know if you're familiar with the day that the condo sales began. They had an information session on the island, so a group of us went and just handed out information to prospective buyers saying that, you know, this might not be in your best interest to buy on this invest in this property. It's on land that doesn't belong to the developers. It's contested, and it's going to be contested for a long time. Mm-hmm. And we did have some immediate success, and people just turned around and left. But others went in, and, you know, that's good. That's good. They'll learn at the end of the day. So, one of the people who is there is our next presenter, who is going to both share some of her music with us and also some of her words. Bela, also known as Blue.
Thank you. Hi, hello. It's a real honor to be on this panel. It's just been fabulous, all the music and the good words. My spirit name on this territory is Nopimi Nagamo, and that means Song of the Forest. I take that name very seriously. And my music, I use the name Bela. That's actually my capoeira name. Capoeira is a Brazilian martial art. And I earned that name through a lot of suffering, a lot of grief. And it means candle. And that's what I want my music to be, is like a candle to offer warmth and light to others. So that's part of my purpose with my music. So I have only really a short amount of time. So I decided to just talk about two things. So I'm obviously a settler ally. My background is Scottish and British. I've been living in Ottawa off and on since I was about one. I was in Guyana, South America before that. And so the first thing I'm going to speak about is what are our responsibilities as settler allies? And I don't have very long, so if this is too quick, you can look on freethefalls.ca, but the first person I'm going to refer to is actually Dr. Lynn Gell. She's Anishinaabe Kwe, and she has a lot of resources for settler allies about being a good ally. And it's very provocative when you read it, and rather demanding. And so I really suggest you start there. And it doesn't matter if you don't agree with it all, that's fine, because you have to decide for yourself what your responsibilities are. But you also have to be willing to keep learning, because you're going to change with what you learn, so it may change your behavior over time. The more you go, it's a journey to become a really good ally. And so one thing, so there's just a few quick points, like guilt is useless, that's paralyzing. What our ancestors did as settlers was horrible, but if we fall into guilt today, then we're not going to be able to take action to make things right. So when we realize that we're benefiting unjustly from what happened in the past, we need to step up and take action to change that so that everyone has a good life. And you know, it's just like I'm sure you've all heard this saying, you know, if you're here to help me, you're wasting your time. If you're here because you know that your liberation is bound up in my own, then let's work together. I think that's a really good thing to keep in mind when you're trying to be a good ally. My friend Matt Brown has written a lot about this, and I'm going to very grossly summarize what he's written to show up, shut up, and stick around. So what that means is, you know, obviously you have to show up and be willing to take action and be an ally, but you need to listen. There's so much to learn. You can't just go into a community and want to take action right away, because you don't know the dynamics, you don't know the people. And by sticking around, that means build relationships. You really need to build relationships with Indigenous people if you're going to make a difference. The other thing I was thinking just while I was sitting there, and Michael was talking about this, is that like you need to really assess the impact your actions are having. So when I think of what's happening with windmill development, and Energy Ottawa as well, like, we got to keep in mind that like, windmill's trying to take over the islands, and Energy Ottawa is trying to further imprison the falls. And what that's doing, especially windmill, is it's causing more division in the Anishinaabe, the Algonquin communities. Now, if that were me, and those, my actions were having that impact, I don't pray or hope I'd have the backbone. I know I would have the backbone to back off. Back way the hell off. And let the indigenous communities sort it out for themselves. So that's one thing. And so one idea that I was asked to talk about specifically is Freeing the Falls and the Freeing Chaudière Falls and its Islands, which is the group that I'm part of, has a new hashtag we're promoting called Move Zibi. So we feel this is a real win-win situation. The Breton Flats needs to be developed. It turns out that windmill development. Windmill development is actually part of Rendezvous Group Consortium, which is one of only two groups to put their bids in on time for developing the Breton Flats. So we're arguing that they could just move ZB over there.
Yes.
And then all the good things that would happen to the communities that want to work with windmill, it still happened. There'd still be jobs for Algonquins, signage in Algonquin. It would be by the Pimsy light rail station, which is Pimsy means eel in Algonquin. So again, like these green condo owners would be closer to public transport, so that's great. So that's an example of a win-win situation. Then the last thing I'm going to talk about before I sing is what are our duties as human beings? And this has been, people have touched on this already. We're all human. We are all connected to the land and the water and the air and the sun and the fire. You don't need a shaman or an elder or an imam or a priest to mediate your relationship to the land. Because you're a human being. As Theta Phoenix puts it, you know, we all bleed red blood, we all have salty tears. So you need to connect, you know, we talk about like a connected world, and that's like internet bullshit, right? What we really need to do is connect to land and water, however that is meaningful for you. Maybe you can reach out to your ancestors, maybe you can talk to elders in your own community and connect with the water, connect with the land, and then listen. You know, and listen without ego, like listen without interpreting it as a human. Listen to what the land and the water really wants. And that's what the song I'm about to sing is about. And then act on it, or don't act. Because you may get a message to act or to not act, and both are very important. And the question really is, like, you can keep asking, like, what can I co-create with this Kichisiki? What can I co-create with Akikodjiwan, with the waterfall, with Asinabka, this sacred area? And then finally, just like having to build relationships with each other and with communities, you need to build a relationship with the land that you're on. Whether you came here because you wanted to, or because you were forced here, or because you've been here since time immemorial, you're here now. So to build a relationship with the land, I really like, John Young has this concept of a study spot. So you go to the same spot every day, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. You know, the animals change when you're there long enough. Their behavior changes. We think of animals as like kind of flitting away and scared. They're not like that when you're there long enough and you drop into their language. So that's a possibility for all of us to do, even if you only have a park. I'm really lucky. I'm on the Kichisiki. I'm in Britannia by Mud Lake. So I go there all the time, and it's really beautiful. But even if you have a city park, you can do that. And so now I'm going to sing my song, because I know we don't have very much time. And I just want to acknowledge, like, this is the Phil Ochs Festival, and I am, like, the biggest Phil Ochs fan ever. I grew up on his music. I'm kind of disappointed I won't get to sing any of his songs this time around. It just didn't work out, but I will have another opportunity later. But in a way, by singing this song to you, I'm actually honoring this tribute to him, because he had such a big influence on me. And the fact that I tend to write songs about issues instead of like love songs. Love songs are great, but not too many of them. The way I do things is probably a little bit different than his, because with this song, which is called Reconciliation River, we've been blocked from the Chaudiere Falls, or the dam covering Chaudiere Falls. But I found this place where I can climb down by the bridge. And I can actually like be there. You just have to get through some bars and stuff like that. There's no trespassing sign or anything. So I haven't been arrested yet, and no one molested me while I'm down there. And I can just see the overflow. And so that's where I went. And I went and I asked, like, is there a song? Do you have a song for me? So this song, it's not from me, like the little ego that wrote it, right? Like this comes from the river and falls. And that's why you'll hear that the voice shift a little bit in it to be the voice of the river. And so I'm really honored to carry this song, and I don't own it. I believe songs have spirit. And so this song, I don't even know what she's gonna do in the world necessarily. Maybe other people are gonna sing this song. All I had to do, my duty, my responsibility was to bring the song into form. And so every time I sing it, and today I'm gonna sing it just my voice, just like I was, like it was given to me originally. Yeah, so thank you very much. And often people want to clap when they hear songs. You don't have to do that. You know, this is my prayer, honestly. So if you want to clap, that's great. If you even want to put your hand to your heart or just be silent, I won't be offended. You know, music has many, many purposes. Thank you. Come back where the waters roar. Come back where our spirits soar. Honor the waters and shores. A sacred space once more. Come back to the place you used to know. Come back to where our spirits grow. There's another way. I asked the river what she wanted to say. I want you to connect. I want you to remember when you knew you were part of all I've joined together. I gave you my heart. Where the waters roar, I gave you my trust. Will you honor me once more? I am not dead. Don't cover me with concrete. I need the green islands where the four elements meet. The river spoke to me. Does she speak to you? This future can be ours. There's loving work to do. Will we act? Be reconciliation with each other and all our relations. Reconciliation with all our relations. Reconciliation for future generations. Reconciliation, conciliation too, cannot be empty words. Action makes it true. Elders have a vision to heal our nation's heart. Chaudière Falls and Islands, are you ready to start? Ready to start. Ready with heart to do your part. Make a place to heal, a place to share, to connect, a place to care. Will we act? Be reconciliation with each other and all our relations. Reconciliation with all our relations. Reconciliation for future generations. The river spoke to me. Does she speak to you? This vision can be ours. There's loving work to do. Loving work to do. Loving work to do.
Thank you. Okay.
Okay, so we have one more presenter. Peter Degagne has been, Degagne, sorry, I spoke, has been, I know, at Octopus Books a couple times in the last few months, making presentations on the history of the Ottawa watershed. And he is going to share some of his knowledge with us as we speak. Very good.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for the introduction. My name is Peter DeGangi, and currently I'm working with the Algonquin Nation Secretariat, which we work for four Algonquin communities: Temiskaming, Barrier Lake, Wolf Lake, and Eagle Village. We've been engaged in research for the past, almost 30 years, I guess, in different ways, on to document Aboriginal title for these communities, because as you know, there's no treaties covering the Ottawa Valley. And I'm honored to be here, and certainly it's been wonderful to hear from the previous speakers. I was trying to put my thoughts together about what I could say that hadn't already been said, or that might be helpful to you folks. So maybe some of the things I'm going to say you've heard already, if that's the case, please indulge me. Otherwise, hopefully you can take something away from this. But as some of the speakers mentioned, the Ottawa Valley has been inhabited for thousands of years. Certainly, it's the traditional territory of the Algonquin Nation, and one of the things the communities I work for have always said very clearly is that there aren't Algonquins of Ontario or Algonquins of Quebec. There are Algonquin people of the Ottawa River watershed, and that imposing those kind of boundaries helps create divisions, and that's one of the reasons why communities I work for feel very strongly about the fact that the provincial border really is an impediment. And because Algonquin people have been here for so long, thousands and thousands of years, we've been reading about the recent publication about the archaeological work that started as early as 1845, where the Museum of History is now an ancient ossuary burial site. You've got to look at the Ottawa River as a highway. It was like the 401. That was the entrance way into the interior of the continent. Indigenous people knew that long before the French came, and the French made use of it as their highway. The people who controlled the Ottawa Valley were basically the gatekeepers for people from the west who wanted to get down into the Atlantic region, or for people going the other way up into the upper lakes. So Algonquin people would have known the area very well and selected the best sites for their habitations. The area around Chaudière Falls would have been like a rest stop. Anybody coming up or down the river would have had to stop there. They would have had to portage. They would have had to camp. They would have met other people on the way up and down the river. So it was a very strategic location, and it was also an area where people naturally would gather. It's not surprising then that Indigenous peoples would have chosen the best locations, because they had a few thousand years to think about it and find out about where the good places were. It also shouldn't come as a surprise that when Europeans came, those were the places they coveted first, because they were the best places where people would gather. And that's something we find certainly with the islands in the Ottawa River. Some of you may know that the Algonquins were traditionally allies of the French, but after 1760, they became allies of the British and became part of the Covenant Chain of Treaties, where the British agreed to protect and to respect the Aboriginal title of Aboriginal nations and enter into treaty. The Royal Proclamation of 1763 was part of that, where King George III said that there would be no land taken unless there was consent. And the Algonquins were there front and center. In fact, the Algonquin and Nipissing chiefs were given a copy of the Royal Proclamation at Niagara in 1764. And as late as the 1840s, they were still waving around the proclamation to the government saying, "You made these commitments to us, what's happened?" One interesting thing about the islands is that starting at least around 1799 or 1800, the Algonquin and Nipissing chiefs actually leased those islands out to settlers. They made arrangements directly with settlers, and people acknowledged they controlled those islands. So basically, from Gatineau all the way up to Deep River, and beyond, those islands were actually being rented out. The Crown heard about it and said, well, you can't deal directly with the settlers, we'll do it on your behalf. And by 1840, the governor of the day basically said, well, we're not going to recognize these rights, we'll just let give the squatters rights. So there's a history to the islands, and I always think about that whenever I think about Chaudiere and Victoria Island and so on. The other thing, I guess, to keep in mind is that there's always been competition over those islands. If you go back turn of the 20th century, or turn of the 19th century, the early 1900s, E.B. Eddy controlled the islands and the water power on the Quebec side, and J.R. Booth controlled the islands and the water power on the Ontario side. And they were litigating against each other over who would get what. In any event, let's fast forward to today and some of the issues. I realize you've been hearing a lot of speakers, and I appreciate their patience. Today, government is using many of the same excuses they've used over the last 300 years for not dealing with Algonquin title and rights. There's third parties everywhere. We can't do it because of this or because of that. So essentially, the land rights don't get dealt with. That's why the communities that I work for have been assembling their evidence to either try and negotiate, or perhaps if they need to go to court to resolve the Aboriginal title issue. The developers of the Zibi project have indicated that, you know, they don't need to consult necessarily because they're third-party owners. It's not their problem, but it is their problem because it's a sacred site, and there's a lot of voices within the Algonquin community and the non-Indian community that are saying they should do the right thing and think more carefully about how they're approaching this. I guess maybe to end things, I'd just like to say, because other speakers have mentioned it, you know, you hear this word bandied about quite a lot these days, reconciliation. I guess what does that really mean? It's easy for something to become a catchword or a slogan and get hijacked. But if we really think about what reconciliation means and what needs to be done at this time, I think the islands at the Chaudière Falls are a good example of what could happen, which is let's stop and step back and really think about what needs to be done given the history of those islands and their meaning, and given especially a lot of the good words that have been coming out of the current government. I'm waiting to see when I think I mentioned this in a previous talk I've given, you know, I'm waiting for the pixie dust to settle and let's get back to reality and see what really happens. But hopefully, there will, you know, there have been some positive signals, and if there is a real intention to reconcile the pre-existing rights of Algonquin people with the current population who live here, then doing the right thing about the development on the Chaudière and Zibi, I think, would be a really good way to start. So we can always be hopeful. If not, then certainly things will enter another phase, I'm sure. But I'd like to thank you for coming out today and for your support. It is important, and that's just good to see so many people out. Thank you.
That water that river, those falls are so important to all of us. And I want to say chumikwich to everyone who is here with a good heart, who cares about the water, who cares about the land, who cares about what is right, what is sacred, what is good. So we're going to go with the Yibi Wabo. If you want to join in, please do.
So yeah, we just turn with each direction.
Yibi Wabo, one guy. Wabo. Everyone, Majoshin.